It's 12:30, and I'm going to get Mr. Michael Angelo Batio on the line. So let's see what I could do. Mr. Michael Angelo Batio, please.
Yeah, this is him.
This is the Tone King. How's it going, man?
Good, how are you?
I have to forewarn you, this conversation is being recorded and we are broadcasting live across YouTube and Ustream, two mediums, live in one pass.
Great.
So,
I'm ready.
How are you?
I'm doing great, can't complain.
Nice, nice. I think the last time I saw you in person was last winter NAMM. It was Sunday, and I promised myself I would take Sunday off and just stroll through, and then I saw you playing at the Eminence booth, and I crawled on the floor like a mouse to capture the whole thing, kind of like in front of everybody, and I think that may be the best coverage we got of you from Winter NAMM 2013.
Oh, yeah, that's when I did my song No Boundaries with Dave Reffitt.
That was amazing, by the way. And not,
oh, cool, thanks.
Not only to have, you know, it was beyond a front row seat, right? I was sitting maybe three feet too close, maybe 5 feet away from you. And to see, you know, I have to be honest with you. When you hear somebody playing like you play, it's almost unbelievable, but when you see it, it's just amazing. It's an amazing experience to see someone like you not only play live but 5 feet away, you know.
Oh, thanks.
There's no trickery. You just know what you're doing. You do it amazingly well, and it was a privilege to have gotten that front row seat to watch you perform. It was really amazing.
For me, that performance was a little bit of a challenge because I used Dave's guitar, and there's only 22 frets, and so I actually had to really improvise a little to play the upper notes of the song because they weren't there on the guitar. But it was fun, and I don't think anyone knew.
So you improvised on the fly to play your song on a guitar that didn't have all the notes and frets that you would typically play that on.
Exactly.
That's amazing. So you know, what I know in my 20 plus years of playing guitar is probably like less than 0.5% of what you know, you know, because, you know, this is, and I've seen your other interviews. You actually went to school for this. You have a degree in this, right? I mean, you're...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have a degree in music. Mm-hmm.
It's not everybody does, right? So that's that puts you at a whole different level than probably most guitar players out there.
Well, thanks. I don't know if it makes me a better guitar player, but I just have, it makes things easier. You know, when you hear a piece of music that sounds strange at first. I mean, everybody hears that. Where, like, I remember when I was a kid listening to Queen for the first time, Killer Queen,
mm-hmm.
the music was so far removed from what I was used to, and even back then in high school I had studied music, and so I had to think of it like a school paper. I mean, I because I couldn't comprehend it at first, and then once I did, then it made it a lot easier to understand it and like it. I mean, I liked it anyway, but I think it's really helped me over the years to get things quicker. You know, I don't have to really work so hard. If I hear something that I don't understand at first, you know, I can think about it more like I would in school, and then I get it. And I think it's been a big help over the years.
Yeah, no, I would agree. You know, the guitar is an interesting instrument because for many, like myself, it's passion driven. So let me use the analogy of a language, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I can't not speak Japanese passionately. You know, you either
right.
know the language or you don't. with guitar, you know the language. I don't know the language, but I could get away playing some notes passionately, right? And to my ears, they sound great. But you can't do that with, let's say, you know, a foreign language. So, you know, and I think that probably holds true for a lot of guitarists. So the fact that you have that degree and the fact that you could, you know, take an instrument that doesn't have the notes and doesn't have the frets, and you could on the fly improvise to play your song the way the song was written, it's amazing. You know, it's almost like you've cracked a code that probably more than half of the guitarists out there, you know, haven't even discovered. It's commendable. Like I said, it's a privilege to not only have seen you, but to have an opportunity to interview you right now.
Oh, thanks.
You know.
Yeah, it's great. I've been looking forward to this.
Yes, we've been...
Have you had a chance to listen to Intermezzo, the new album?
I did. You know, let's talk about, and I just want to be sensitive to the folks that are on both Ustream and YouTube. So Michael Angelo Batio recently came out with an album called Intermezzo. He's coordinated with a tremendous amount of artists, to name a few: Elliot Dean Rubinson, Dave Reffitt, Jeff Loomis, Rusty Cooley, George Lynch, and more. Michael Angelo Batio. How would you like me to address you, by the way? Mr. Angelo? Mr. Batio? Okay, Mike. Okay. What was it, you know, tell me a little bit about the album, and then my next question is, what was it like coordinating with so many different A-list artists?
Yes, well, what I wanted to do with Intermezzo is a musical term. Obviously, it's Italian. The word means in between. Intermezzo is a piece of music that was primarily used in between an intermission of a long musical work. Like, say, you had a four-hour opera.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, people can't sit through 4 hours.
Right.
But what they did was they take an intermission, and then depending on where they were, they would have the most famous local composer of the era write an intermezzo, and many times it was almost more popular than some of the operas themselves. And for me, it's a metaphor. So I had the title before I even started the album, and that's where the title track came. But for me, it's a metaphor of my career. I mean, I've been very, you know, blessed. I mean, I've had this amazing musical career. I mean, 54 countries. You know, I get on the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and you know, it's just, I mean, we've got tons of shows booked for next year already, and I never take it for granted. But I thought, I'm in this intermezzo phase because there's another part of the career that's being unfolded now, and that's that second half,
mm-hmm.
and the second part. So that's what the album was about, and you know, it's all original new music, and I wanted to make it as creative, and I wanted to be like me, but not a rehash.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, you know, I didn't want to be to people to say, well, you know, Michelangelo sounds in 2014 like he sounded like in 1998 or 2000. And I really made a concerted effort to do that. And then the second part of your question about working with the guest artists,
mm-hmm.
The last three or four records, I've always had some really great guest stars. Like on my Hands Without Shadows album, I had Mark Tremonti play a guest solo, Rudy Sarzo, and, you know, Bobby Rock play drums, my old drummer from Nitro. And
mm-hmm.
and then I wanted Intermezzo to have just a lot of great players. And there's a young guitarist named Dave Reffitt, who I'm really good friends with. He's a great player. We know a lot of people in common, but he's really, like, close friends with George Lynch, and you know, I know George, but not as well as Dave, and once we started talking, and between him and I, we started throwing out names, and between the two of us, once George Lynch was the first major artist we got.
Mm-hmm.
Once we got him, then Jeff Loomis signed on, then Craig Goldie from Dio, and then you know, we got Rusty Cooley, and then Michael Romeo from Symphony X, and Mike LePond, his bass player, Chris Poland. It's like once you get a few big names, all the other big names feel comfortable knowing it's really, really, it's a real deal. So So, okay, with Snowball, we could have, if I would have released the album a little bit later, we could have gotten even more, but I had to draw the line, and I love every solo that every one of the artists did. Everybody brought their A game to the table, and it turned out great.
You know, that all sounds amazing, and I want to focus on one particular point that you said, and that was really about Dave Reffitt. So for those folks tuning in, I met Dave back at Winter NAMM, and he kept up with you, which I thought, so not only were you amazing, but to see him stand by your side playing, you know, in sync with you was even more amazing. You know, that few minutes of seeing Dave Reffitt and you play your song was amazing. And I met Dave, and it's funny because we're here right now conducting this interview because I kept in touch with Dave, and you know, he was telling me about the album and the artists, and here we are. So, you know, a big thank you to Dave Reffitt for staying in touch, and it says a lot about not only him and you, but him, because like you said, he's very well connected, and you know, he takes pride and passion in doing what he does, and the hat's off to you for being so receptive to that, right? Because when you take someone like Dave, who, you know, a lot of people just like, oh, leave me alone, let me do what I want to do. But the fact that you're so open to coordinating with other artists and working with other artists, it just makes it that much bigger, right?
And I agree. And, you know, it's, you know, a lot of times guitar players, and in fact, you know, I mean, I came up in the L.A. scene in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it was when Racer X, and, you know, I knew Paul Gilbert. We've mm-hmm. known each other forever. Tony McAlpine, I was at Yngwie's first show. But it was a lot different era then, because it was so competitive that guitarists, you know, we all went to see each other's shows, but it was really difficult for any guitarist to work with any other guitarist.
Right.
It just wasn't there. But now, I think it's a whole new school. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have a whole network of great players. For example, Guthrie Govan.
Yep.
You know, he's amazing. And I met Guthrie a long time ago not a long time ago, but about 2005, 2006 in the UK. And when we talked to him about being on the record, he had said, well, if I like, I wrote a song that's a tribute to Dave Brubeck, and it's called 5/4 Ever. And so it's in the, you know, time signature of 5/4 and a lot of other things, but it's a fusion song.
Right.
And I asked Guthrie, you know, to play it, and he said, well, and then Dave spoke to him as well, because Dave, again, you know, he had the connection to mm-hmm. immediately get to him. And Guthrie said, well, if I want to hear the whole song, not just the solo section, and if I like it, if I can contribute, I'll play on it. And then we didn't hear anything from Guthrie probably for about 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the record wasn't being mixed yet, so it was plenty of time. And next thing I know, I get an email, and there's Guthrie solo.
Wow.
And it's amazing. And not only did he do one, he did two on the record.
Wow.
So it's just one of those things. So, but it was fun because we're all friends. Like, every guitarist on this record, I'm not only a fan of, I'm a mm-hmm. friend of, and it was really fun doing it because, you know, everybody had that same spirit. It wasn't competition. I wanted everybody's best work.
Sure.
I'm not trying to outdo them. I wanted everybody's greatest guitar solo they could do to make the record better.
Right. And for those tuning in, you know, there's several songs on Intermezzo. And this 5/4 Ever, as an example, has Guthrie Govan on it. Pillars of Steel has George Lynch on it, etc. There's a lot of different artists. I would strongly encourage everyone to check it out. But more so because, let's face it, you know, like, let's pick any guitarist. George Lynch will always sound like George Lynch. Eddie Van Halen will always sound like Eddie Van Halen, and you'll always sound like you. But when you mix it up and bring this many artists in to collaborate, you're really just opening up and making it dynamic, which is exciting. I mean, that's, you know, that's probably the most exciting part. Is not only is it a collaboration, but you really get to appreciate different styles, people's, you know, different players' approach to how they do it. I mean, you look at Guthrie Govan and George Lynch; they're completely different guitarists, and to have them both play on the same CD is pretty wild and amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, I was really pleased, and you know, it kind of took on a life of its own, and I think if we would have done this, quote, in the old days, unquote, using analog tape, mm-hmm. I would have had to write all new songs. But with the technology as it exists, one, everybody could do it in their own studio. You know, nobody had to come to my studio, mm-hmm. so they got their best work in. And two, for example, on that song, Eight Pillars of Steel, I had a 30-second solo section that every guitar player played over. Mm-hmm. So you could hear each person's take on the same progression. And George played over the allotted time. And like about 5 seconds, I was like, oh, man. And so I talked to my engineer, and what we did is we had a lot of extra drum fills, and, you know, we did a lot of extra things. Metallica did that on the Black album, where they had Lars just do a bunch of extra stuff so they could use it later if they found they needed it. And so what we did was we elongated the solo section for everybody else.
Nice.
We couldn't have done that, you know, if it was yesterday's technology. So it just all worked out. I mean, the album kind of took on a life of its own when all these great creative players started putting their piece to the puzzle. It was really cool.
Mm-hmm. So here's another question for you.
Sure.
When I was listening to the album, isn't it funny how we all, you know, we're talking about technology, but we all still call it an album?
Yeah, I don't even know what to call it anymore, a record.
I know.
Can't call it a CD.
It's.
So I kind of use the record and album.
Yep, same here. Meanwhile, if I told my kids, you know, the album, they look at me funny, you know. So if you take... If
I
you
know my 12-year-old nephew, Uncle Mike, a cassette?
Right.
You know, it's funny
when you listen to the old cassettes, that it's actually, you know, because it's not zeros and ones. Sometimes you'll hear artifacts that simply never make it into the binary format, which is kind of interesting.
Yeah, I used to love them.
Yep. So if you take a look at Overload, so for the folks tuning in, there's two songs. There's one called Overload Intro, and then there's another one called Overload. So Overload has a kick-ass intro. I mean, it's not only well-produced, but it just kind of hits you between the eyes, right? And then you have Overload Intro, which has a nice acoustic ring to it. It's you know, kind of polar opposite. So when you're writing a song, how do you determine if, you know, you go full in, full bore, like Overload, or you do something kind of mellow and bring it in with Overload Intro? How do you go about the composition to get something so dynamic?
Well, the first seven songs are my compositions.
Okay.
The Overload Intro, believe it or not, here's another collaboration, is not me playing. It is a guitarist named Florent Adam. He's from Tahiti. He's a Grammy-nominated Tahitian guitar player.
Ah, I did not know that.
And the song was mixed by a Grammy award-winning Hawaiian engineer. Engineer that's mixed like Hawaiian music. And so I used all sorts of different players. And it's actually, Florent is a huge fan of mine. And we actually omitted the first part of it because he made the first part sound so much like me. He said it was a tribute. And I said, well, Florent, it's great to do a tribute to me, but don't tribute me on my own record. And so what we did was we kept him. He does this thing called a slide picking technique, which gets all those arpeggios the way he did it. But that's actually his contribution to the record.
Interesting. So that clearly explains how, you know, it's so dynamic. Overload Intro and then Overload. It was like, wow. But now that all makes sense. That makes sense. And to be clear for those tuning in, they're both kick-ass. You definitely want to check Intermezzo out, but like Overload, perhaps that was maybe my favorite song on the album. What was your favorite, if you don't mind me asking?
I like Intermezzo the best, and another one called Oceans of Time.
Okay.
See, those are my songs. Overload actually was with Dave. That was a collaboration with Dave Ruffett.
Got it.
And, you know, he's just got that metal killer sound, and I played the first solo. We have, on that song alone, on Overload, I'm playing, we have Dave playing, we have a female guitarist named Annie Grunwald, I hope I said her name correctly, from Berkeley. We had Chris Pullen from Megadeth, Mike LaPon, Symphony X's bass player, Michael Romeo, Symphony X's guitarist, and Guthrie Govan all on one song. It's just ripping.
That's amazing. That's amazing. It's you know, you may be in territory that nobody's been in before. I don't know of any other artist that had made an album that has collaborated with so many other artists. This is really commendable, and it's worth anyone checking out. I mean, you know, you have a tremendous roster of artists here. It's almost like having your own Lollapalooza on your album, isn't it?
Yeah, it was, you know, for me it was fun. And I guess, if you know, when people think about, you know, when you do instrumental guitar, kind of the mold of a lot of players is they're kind of armies of one. You know, they record everything themselves, they mix it, they...
You still there? I think he went away. It just, Michael Angelo, I'm not sure if you could still hear me, but it seems like your voice just cut out abruptly. Hello? I think I may need to call him back because his voice cut out. Are you there? Hello? Nope, I think I lost him. Let me hang up and redial. If he was on a cell phone, that may explain it. Maybe battery died or something. Let's try this again.
Customer you are trying to reach is currently
okay. So let's give that a minute. I suspect he was having a perhaps technical difficulty with the phone or the phone line. So we'll give him a couple of minutes. I'll try him back. Just so everybody knows, if you've just joined, I've been keeping an eye on the comments. I am on the line with Michael Angelo Batio. We're talking about his album called Intermezzo. The thing we've been talking about probably for the last 20 minutes is, you know, about the new album and all the coordination. He has a lot of A-list artists that he's been coordinating with, which is really exciting. So, I will leave an opportunity for questions and answers. So if you have any questions for him, please leave them either on YouTube or Ustream. I'm looking at both windows. I have both chat windows open, and I will go through the questions for Michael. So and also, just to be clear, in case you missed it, there is about 30 to 40 second latency, a delay on YouTube side. In the description on the YouTube video, I have the link to Ustream, and there's no latency on the Ustream chat. So if you want to join there, you're welcome to. It will be in more real time. So keep asking your questions, and let me try Michael again. Hang on. Michelangelo, I lost you.
Yeah, sorry, I don't know what happened.
I don't know either. You were kind of right in the middle there. Do you want to...
I remember what I was saying. I apologize. Okay. I'm not sure. Maybe it's the bad weather here in Chicago.
Gotcha.
But,
okay.
No, I was saying that, you know, a lot of guitar players, they like to do things on their own.
Mm-hmm.
You know, produce it, write it, mix it, master it, put it out. But I've never really been like that. Even if I do a solo show,
mm-hmm.
I don't mix my own records. I have a really great engineer.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, he was from the death metal band Jungle Rot. He's a great bass player, but he's a younger guy that came up in the Pro Tools era. And I've never done my own CD covers. I have a network of people that I work with, and I think that's been the biggest secret of why I've been successful. I mean, I learned a long time ago to get other people to do jobs that they do better than you.
Right.
And so, and that's how it works, at least for me, maybe not for anyone else, but it, you know, it's like even somebody like Dave, he was really helpful and instrumental in bringing the record to the level that it is. And without him, I really couldn't have done it. And so, but you need people like that. And that's how I look at it.
Absolutely. Even in, and so I agree with you wholeheartedly. Even in my little world, you know, I have the website, and I depend on, I have graphic artists that do the artists. Every piece of written content that goes on the website goes through Mark Johnson, who's my editor. And I depend on them to keep it wholesome and worthy enough for people to read. So I'm with you 100%. You know, surrounding yourself by the right people that could help you be the best that you could be, you know, if that allows you to focus and concentrate on, you know, the skill set that you're a master of, which is playing the guitar, then that works out. I mean, that just makes sense on many different levels, business sense, time management sense, the whole bit, right?
I think so. You know, I mean, it's the lone wolf syndrome. You know, I travel on a pack. I mean,
right.
That's just the way I like to do it. It's more fun, but I get better work that way.
Yep.
Whether it's designing a guitar, whether it's working with Dean guitars, whether it's doing a record, even when I record, I have my own studio. It's really nice, but I have my engineer Chris come over. He mics up my amps.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't just rely on my own ear and my own expertise. He sets the mic pre's. So I rely on his ear, and then as I'm recording, he'll come to my studio. He'll check everything out, make sure everything's good. And then even when we transfer tracks, I don't do it. I have him do it. So, you know, I want the best guy to do the Pro Tools expert. I mean, I'm good at tracking, but I don't worry about EQing. I don't worry about effects. I have other people do that, and it makes it a lot less stress because I know when I record something, it's recorded as good as it can be, and then I know that it's going to be mixed good.
Right,
So it's for me, it's just a lot less stress.
You know, and I think there's a lesson for folks, you know, folks that tune in, folks that heard that, there's a lesson to be learned. You know, focus on the things that you're good at, focus on the things that you like, and if there's an obstacle between you having success with the things that, you know, make you tick, you know, leverage other people to help you get that job done, right? Because let's face it, we're not all masters of everything. We're just not.
You know, my dad used to have a saying. My dad had a lot of good sayings, but he used to tell me, he said, it's better to be the master of one than a player of many.
Yep.
And now some people might disagree, saying, well, it's good to learn different styles in music. And I agree. I mean, I know a lot of different styles, but I think that to be known for something, when you think of any artist that's really successful, you don't think of them in terms of being able to do everything.
That's right.
You think of, you know, pick a name, pick a band, and it conjures up an image and a style.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's what my dad meant, and that's kind of the way I look at it.
And you're in a whole other level of guitar playing. You truly are a master of your art. You're a master of your craft. And, you know, it just makes sense. And that's what you focus on. And that is your success. You know, life is short. And someday, you know, people say, Michael Angelo Batio, he was the best at what he did. And, you know, you allowed yourself to get there. And it just all makes sense. I think it's commendable at many different levels. You know, the whole approach, strategy, and the fact that you're articulating this, because I'm sure there's a lot of young budding guitar players that'll listen to it and learn from it and follow, take your advice. Let's face it. You know, you've been around.
Well, you know, the other side of it, too, is, I mean, when you listen to Intermezzo, I mean, I take the playing so serious, but live, I have fun.
Right.
I mean, I came up with that over-under technique. That's another side of what I like to do. I mean, I'm a creative person, and I didn't want to copy other guitar players, but going to school, when I studied Bach, Beethoven, Mozart, I can name 100 other composers, I started looking at Led Zeppelin and Jimi Hendrix and the Beatles and you know, Black Sabbath, you know, Judas Priest. I started thinking about them, like, what if I was studying these guys in a class, and what do they have in common? And what I started to look at is that one, they have the music first.
Mm-hmm.
Two, they have a way live to portray it. I mean, does Iron Maiden really need Eddie? No. But I know Steve Harris. He's got Eddies everywhere. It's something that is a really cool live thing that they use. And I mean, did Jimi Hendrix need to smash guitars or Jimmy Page need to use a bow? None of the above.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't mean anything to the music, but it meant something live. So I said, well, I don't need to play my double guitar in the studio, but if I have this double guitar live, I have something that my heroes had too. I have something that makes me different live.
Mm-hmm.
That's that other side. That's a totally other side of it. And it's one of the things that, one of the reasons, you know, I get so many shows besides the music. You know, I have this wild live show that I can do that sets me apart from anybody else on the planet.
Yep. So
but that's that other side.
You mentioned a couple of things there. You mentioned the over-under playing. You mentioned the what do you call the double neck guitar? Matter of fact, for the folks tuning in, hang on, let me just show them a picture. I printed out a couple of pictures here. So this is this here is a picture of Michael Angelo Batio playing live. And you could see he has this wild, I'm almost hesitant to call it a double neck guitar because it's kind of a non-traditional double neck guitar. And I have a couple of different shots here of how you play this. You play the guitar with your left and right hand, and then you like invert the guitar so you're looking at the back of the guitar. And you could tell you're really in this picture right here, you're really just kind of working it to its fullest. How did this guitar come to be?
For people who've never seen it, or it's, you know, think of it, it's shaped like a V.
Yep.
It's a double V neck, but I just call it the double guitar,
mm-hmm.
but it's really left and right handed. And what made it cool is Steve Vai did a version of my guitar, gave me credit, said he got it from me. Then Jack Black and Tenacious D in the Pick of Destiny did a version of my double guitar. There's a new vodka commercial, a girl's holding a double guitar. And so I was in a Kia commercial last year, a TV commercial, where they wanted specifically my double. It's really become, there's no question it's a gimmick. But I mean, so is Page using a bow or Hendrix smashing a guitar. It's not meant to be really a studio thing, but my double has caught on to some major people and major companies, and it was really cool to see it. You know, I was very honored when Steve Vai did a version of my guitar, seeing the movie The Pick of Destiny,
mm-hmm.
they did an interview with Jack Black, and he's going off talking about me, and you know, he's a fan, and not only did he have two neck guitars, he had four necks. I mean, they knew all about it.
They
said they got their version of the double from mine, so I thought it was really cool.
Michael Angelo, I am going to respectfully disagree with you on something, because you just said it's a gimmick, and I am going to respectfully disagree and say it's not a gimmick, because what you're doing is an art, and there's no rules in art. This is who you are. This is your creation. This is what you do to perform your art.
That's true. Thank you.
It's not a gimmick. This is you. This is your show. And in your show, this is what you do. And, you know, this is what makes you who you are. So to say it's a gimmick is almost undermining your performance, your show. And the truth is that this is, I remember I've been watching you back from the, what was it? Doug Mark days, right?
Mm-hmm, that's right.
And, you know, you've had this for a long time, and this defines who you are. It's like Eddie Van Halen saying a striped guitar is a gimmick. It's not. It's who he is, and this is who you are. So hopefully you don't mind that I respectfully disagreed with you, but this is way beyond any sort of gimmick. This is who you are. This is your creation, and you know, this is the stuff we all leave behind, right? The stuff that defines who we are. And I feel strongly about it. There are things I do that defines who I am. And I don't think any of it's a gimmick. I just think it's who we are. It's what defines who we are.
No, I agree. I guess what I meant too, but no, you are correct, and I appreciate that. Thanks. It's a live vehicle.
That's right.
And what I did with the double, I mean, I'm left-handed. There was a jazz saxophonist. He actually played more than just sax, but his name was Rahsaan Roland Kirk.
Mm-hmm.
He was a blind jazz player, and I saw him when I was a kid. It was on a public television station called WTTW. In fact, it's still on Chicago. It's a cable show now, cable network.
Mm-hmm.
And they used to have concerts every weekend. You know, they would show jazz, they would show classical, blues, rock, every genre you could think of, country. But I remember watching him, and at the end of the show, he played two saxophones at the same time. And
wow.
I was this 11-year-old kid going, I'm going to do that on guitar.
Mm-hmm.
But the difference is, he played two right-handed saxophones, but my double guitar is truly lefty. And it, you know, when people, when I sign autographs and, you know, it shows, it the very end, especially in certain meet and greets, I let people hold the guitar.
Nice.
When you watch it on YouTube or you see me play it,
mm-hmm.
you think, oh, yeah, I can do that. But the guitar itself weighs 15 pounds.
Right.
And then to try and play it left-handed, crisscross left-handed, over the neck, all this stuff, when people actually wear it and just get a feel for just how it feels before they even play a note,
mm-hmm.
it kind of puts it all together, because it, you know, it's not really as easy as it seems.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, it's like you said, it defines who I am. I love playing it.
Nice.
I really do. Every show I look forward to playing that guitar.
Nice. I do want to cover two other topics. I want to talk about your tour schedule, and I also
sure.
want to give the folks tuning in an opportunity to ask questions, and they've been asking lots of questions on the chat. But before I get to those other two items, I do want to ask you something. I am personally I collect guitars and amps and all that stuff. In fact, that was kind of the launch of what I do here, you know, with the birth of technology. I was able to start blogging and vlogging and all that. So your guitar is really not available. And I remember talking to a company. As a matter of fact, it was Dean Guitars. I own the Dave Mustaine Double Neck V. And we were talking, and he said, guys who collect double neck guitars, it's a niche of a niche, you know. And I would challenge you to work with Dean on getting an affordable copy of your guitar into the public's hands, because even for the niche of a niche, it's something nice that you can offer to your fans and, you know, guys like me that just dig the wild and crazy stuff out there. And it's cool to see it, but it would be even better to own it. So maybe in your next, you know, round table with the powers that be at Dean, maybe you should say, hey, you know, let's do a small run, affordable run of my Michael Angelo Batio guitar.
That's a great idea, because, you know, we did this latest double that I have. We put it in the CNC machine because, you know, Dean Guitars, their USA factory. It's in Tampa, Florida, and they
yep.
can, you know, they have their custom shop. But right now, they can do a USA double exactly like mine, but it's very pricey.
Right.
And so I think you're right. I'll talk to the owner, Elliot, and see, you know, because he's such a great businessman, and he even does a guest spot on my album. He plays bass.
Yes, I noticed that. He plays bass on Pillars of Steel.
That's right. Did you hear that bass solo? He's like Jaco Pastorius.
Yep.
He's a great player. He's really great.
Yep. Yeah, and that's, you know, when I said affordable, I was, you know, clearly meant something, you know, maybe imported. Because Dean Guitars, you know, they make USA stuff, they make imported stuff. But I have to tell you, you know, I think all their guitars are pretty high quality. You know, it all comes down to quality control and what they will and will not allow as a company. And, you know, I own, like I said, I own the Dave Mustaine, and it's imported. And I would say it's the quality is fantastic. The beautiful thing about any imported instrument is, you know, it gets in it's more affordable, gets in the hands of more players, right? But yeah, I would love to see that for many reasons, for you, for Dean, and just, you know, to get your creation in the hands of, you know, that niche of a niche.
No, you're right. It would be really cool. And I'm going to see him in a couple of weeks coming up at the NAMM show.
You got to give me some props for coming up with the idea, though.
I definitely will.
All right.
Yeah, it's great. No, I'm so happy to be on the show, too.
Cool.
Yeah, it's funny, you know, people have been telling me, oh, you've got to get on the show. And so, you know, your show's super popular. It's great. I'm
cool.
Glad to be here.
Well, thank you. So Let's talk about tour schedule. What do you have planned for 2014?
Well, it's already in the works. I'm starting in roughly 3 weeks.
Okay.
We're doing this NAMM Metal Jam with, I'm going to be there, Dave Ruffett will be there, Neil Turbin, the original singer from Anthrax, Shane Gibson from Korn, the list goes on and on. We do this celebrity jam. Last year we had members of Queensryche, and you know, Herman Lee was there, and this year it's more of the same. So that's show one. Then 2 days later, we're doing two shows. We're doing one in Anaheim on Friday.
Okay.
The Friday night of NAMM.
Is that the NAMM Jam?
Pardon?
Is that the NAMM Jam?
No, this is actually called Extreme Cream.
Ah, okay.
We're doing a tribute to the classic rock band Cream, but it's sponsored by Kofi Baker, Ginger Baker, the original Cream drummer's son. And then I'm going to be on stage. The acts are, my band's going to play, Elliot will be on bass, and my singer and drummer. We're going to play with Doug Aldrich from Whitesnake, Uli John Roth, Gary Hoey, and we're all, it's a Cream-based and Eric Clapton-based show. So I'm doing a couple of my versions of Cream songs, and then, you know, we do some of my stuff too with the double guitar. And so those are the first shows, and then I've got shows scheduled in China, in Europe. There's probably 50 shows already scheduled for next year. I mean, it's going to be really busy. So I can't complain. It's rocking.
That's awesome. So in how many shows would you say you'll do in 2014? What how many shows are on the roster that you're aware of?
Well, I have a minimum number of shows that I do every year,
mm-hmm.
and it's at least 100.
Wow.
So there's no question that 2014 will have at least 100 shows, and probably more like 120, 130.
You know, if you think about 100 shows, the time it takes to travel to those shows, that's you're touring whole year round.
I'm on the road about at least 200 plus days.
You know, you compare that to you know, the summer tours are big, right? You know, summer rolls around, everyone's on tour, and then once back to school starts, everything pretty much shuts down. The fact that you're doing that year round is pretty wild. It's got to be exhausting.
You know, it is, but I love it. I mean, I've been to 54 countries.
Wow.
I can sit here for 3 weeks and talk about, you know, having a personal tour of Stonehenge. I literally was 1 foot away from the center stone in Stonehenge. Nobody gets to see this stuff. And, you know, I've climbed pyramids in Mexico. I climbed the Great Wall in China this year. I've seen the only orangutan wildlife sanctuary in one of the islands of Indonesia.
Wow.
That's on the planet. I mean, I can go on and on, and it's all because of playing a guitar.
That's amazing, isn't it?
You never take that for granted. And, you know, while yes, the job is really tiring. I mean, people think that it's easy to fly 12,000 miles to Australia, get off a plane, and do a show. It's not. It beats you up, but I love it. And I want to do it for as long as I can. I never get tired of it.
Nice. Well, good for you. I mean, it's inspiring to hear that. That's great stuff. So for those tuning in, check. I'm assuming it's all on your website. Before I get to the questions, do you want to plug any websites, Twitter account, Facebook pages? The floor is yours.
Sure. Yeah, my website is pretty easy to find, angelo.com. And I've had my own label for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So you can get all my CDs and DVDs. We have a really successful online company. That's what we do. We ship my stuff everywhere. And, you know, it's all secured. You know, it goes through PayPal. And, you know, everything's really professional and dialed in. I've got an office that handles it. But angelo.com. And then if you want to, my CDs are distributed digitally worldwide. I mean, you can pretty much every main digital outlet or go to Amazon, you name it, my stuff's there.
Nice. So there you have it. So, Michelangelo, thank you for all that. What I'm going to do is there's a bunch of questions here. So I'll read you who's asking the question. I'll read you the question. And if you just want to give kind of a short answer to help these guys out with some of the questions they have, I think that would be great.
Sounds good.
So Jeremy Gordon says, Michael, what advice would you give to somebody trying to learn to shred as fast as they can?
I buy my Speed Kills DVD. Or not mine, get John Petrucci's. Buy a professional DVD. You know, you can, maybe it's on YouTube, but learn from the pros. Because the DVD format is still really great. You can have picture-in-picture, screen, tab. I mean, my Speed Kills, it helped Herman Lee. It helped, I mean, John Petrucci, Mark Tremonti, Tom Morello, Michael Romeo. A lot of people learn from my stuff. You know, really big-time pros, Dimebag. But they learn from the videos because you can just play it over and over and over. That's what I would recommend. And private lessons.
Private lessons and Speed Kills. Okay. Well, there you have it. Let me see. I'm scrolling through. There's a lot of questions here. Just bear with me if you don't mind. Michael, do you listen to any blues guitarists?
Yes. And I love the blues. In fact, I do a song called Nuclear Blues. But I think that I play blues my own way. And I love Johnny Winter and B.B. King. And, you know, I even love Joe Bonamassa. I think he's great.
So here's a recommendation for you from Dan Benkert. He's encouraging you to check out a guitarist called Panos Arvantis. He's in Greece, and I've actually seen his stuff. He's, you know, YouTube has created the birth of, you know, just talent. And this guy Panos is a tremendous guitarist, and Dan Benkert is suggesting maybe you know, if you're ever online, you know, look for his name and check out his guitar playing. Maybe someday you'll be collaborating.
Cool. Sounds good.
He also wrote, he bought the Candy Apple Red Metallic MAB3, kept it completely stock. So, you know, we have some fans here that actually
Great.
Own your Signature Series stuff.
Tell them thank you.
Yeah, I will. So there you go, Dan. He says thank you. Let's see. Let me go through here. Let's see what some of the other questions are. You know, the comments come in so fast, I have to scroll up to take a look at them.
That's a good thing.
Yeah. Let's see.
It's rocking.
Somebody had asked about what, in terms of like guitar models, do you have anything new coming out for 2014?
Yes. You know, I have many signature models with Dean. My new 7-string Intermezzo features my new 7-string MAB7. For 2014, we took one of my signature guitars and literally had a person who works with metals burn the guitar.
Wow.
Really torch this thing. It's not a graphic. It sounds amazing. And we're showing the first prototype, well, the first production model at NAMM. It's going to be the burnt MAB guitar. Wait till you see this. It's incredible. And it sounds amazing.
Got it. Well, I'll definitely be at the Dean booth, and I'll make sure I get that on film. You know, I upload that evening, so hopefully I'll be the first one to the punchline on that one to show the world that new guitar. Good stuff, good stuff. Let's see what else we have. Please ask Michelangelo, when recording the guitars, what was the signal chain, and did you use DI at all?
No. My signal chain is extremely simple. I do not use a lot of effects. When I record rhythm, and I don't go wireless in the studio, you know, only live, when in concert, but it's really this simple. Guitar, chord, overdrive, chord into the amp, that's it. And then when I do... that's for a distortion sound, for a clean sound. I'll use, you know, guitar, cable, slight bit of compression, just a little Boss compressor into the clean channel. And I never record with effects. I never record with delay, never record with reverb. On Intermezzo, I didn't even use a wah. I don't like to rely on wahs. A lot of people, they rely on that mid-range frequency to feel comfortable. But I have the most simple signal chain you could possibly imagine. And live, I use the same thing, only a little bit of delay, but it's not a lot of overdrive on the amp, a lot of mid-range, and when I want overdrive, I use my distortion pedal. and I use a TS9 tube screamer. They're great.
Nice. And you also, you use the dime amps, correct?
Sometimes, but I mostly use in the studio. Sometimes I use those live, but in the studio, I'm really a Marshall.
Okay.
I just love Marshall amps. I use the JCM2000s. I have a JMP1 that I use, and I'll take the power amp part of my Marshall JCM2000. You put the JMP1 through that. But, you know, I'm more of a Marshall guy. I just love the mids of Marshalls, and I don't like a lot of overdrive on amps. I'm more old school in that respect. If you heard my sound without an overdrive, you'd swear it's a blues guitar sound or a classic rock sound. It's just that overdrive and the way I play adds my tone.
Got it. Okay. By the way, we have a lot of Randall fans here, and someone called out. They said back in the day you used to use a Randall amp.
I liked Randall a lot. I still like them. Mm-hmm.
Nice. Somebody wants to know, by the way, the person that asked about the signal chain was Peter J. Cruz Music. So he was the one that asked that. Hot Rod V says, what are your favorite pickups?
Well, I have my own signature pickup from Dean. It's called the Hands Without Shadows. So that's my favorite. My second favorite, is Tide. For passive, got to go with Seymour Duncan. I think they're the best. For active, I like AMGs.
Nice.
So you know, different pickups for different applications, but you can't go wrong with the AMGs, you can't go wrong with Duncan's, and my signature pickups and the Dean USA pickups are great.
Nice.
So between those three, I've got it covered.
You know, I recently did an unboxing of a guitar, and about halfway in, I gave players a tip, and I'll repeat that here. Just because you said, you know, AMGs are great for active, and Duncan's for passive, and then you have your own. The truth is, you know, there's lots of different options with any guitar, and there's really no right or wrong. And when you pick up a guitar that has actives, you'll get a different tone than passives. And chances are, not only yourself, but I'm sure lots of musicians use all of the above. It really just depends on the application, doesn't it?
That's right. Yeah, I mean, I love guitars. Like you were saying, you know, you're into guitars and amps. I have about 130 guitars. When I record, it's impossible to use just one guitar.
Yep.
I can't do it. I have some songs require a different sound. And it's like you said, EMGs have this certain sound. It's EMG. I use that sometimes. For me, a passive pickup is more expressive. You know, like EMGs are just loud, but I love them, and I find that I use both. You know, it just depends what it is.
I have Hot Rod V saying, what model Duncan's? And by the way, just in case you're wondering why, you know, there's so many specifics on the gear, that's one of the kind of the core of, you know, a lot of the content I cover is all about the gear. So you have a bunch of gear heads on here. So they're asking what kind of strings and what specific pickups, because these guys kind of gear.
Here's what I have. I know, you know, I'm a good friend of Seymour's.
Okay.
Seymour Duncan. I mean, I know his son. And, yeah, I've known Seymour for a long, long time. Dream are so super hot for me. F-Space.
Willing to put something together.
They're awesome.
Nice. Nice. Good stuff. Let's see if there's any more here, and then we'll wrap it up. Let's see. I think that probably covers everything. I mean, we went through amps and guitars and signal chains and, you know, recommendations and tour dates and all that stuff. So I think that probably covers it. You know, we could keep this line open for 3 hours and the questions will continue to trickle in. But for anybody that is tuning into the playback, there's plenty of information here on Michael Angelo Batio, from the guitars to the new album, Intermezzo, tour dates, the whole bit. So thank you, Mr. Michael Angelo Batio, for giving me an opportunity to call you up in the wee hours of the morning to have this interview with you. It was truly a pleasure, an honor, and a privilege to have that opportunity. So from me to you, thank you very much for that.
Oh, thanks. And hopefully I'll see you at NAMM.
I will definitely be at NAMM. You know, we'll connect one way or another, and happy holidays and happy new year. Thank you so much.
Cool. Thank you.
Okay, take care.
Bye.
Bye-bye.